We're not just geologists, we're not just biologists, we're not just geochemists, we are everything combined. They really get the big picture of what happened to the ocean around Hunga-Tonga Hunga-Ha'apai.
Tsunami is hitting Tonga right now after more severe volcanic activity there.
Tonga's capital, Nuku'alofa, is covered in a thick film of volcanic dust.
It was so violent, it affected a continent on the other side of the Pacific Ocean. It literally moved air and water on a global scale. We timed the arrival to Hunga-Tonga Hunga-Ha'apai-volcano just for sunrise, and that was an issue because of safety. We wanted to approach it in daylight in case there was any activity on it. But that first moment where the sun rising and out of the darkness these two jagged peaks emerged was actually really emotional. These islands are just being ripped to bits. I mean, they just ooze violence. They're black and charred, sharp and jagged, and they just look like devastation.
I was scared for my life because I haven't really experienced something like that, let alone have experienced like a shockwave like that or even heard of a volcano eruption happening.
There's a famous quote by the forefathers of the current king. The translation is that my people are poor because of lack of knowledge. So accounting for what's happened and planning for the future is that we have to build our knowledge base to be able to develop a prosperous community.
One of the key things about this volcano, and again, it's very unique in the Pacific Rim of Fire, it was very close to the water. So we know that in January the 14th of 2022, it erupted with a mild eruption that actually removed part of the island and exposed the crater to the water. And we also know that cold water and seawater and lava will mix very explosively. TESMAP is a collaboration between the Nippon Foundation and NIWA, and the purpose of this project is to remap the seafloor to find out what changes have happened and try and understand the mechanics about what made those changes and what the implications are of those changes to life on the seafloor and within the waters around Tonga. And the way we map the seafloor is through a device we call a multi-beam echo sounder.
Multi-beam echo sounders work by just transmitting an acoustic pulse, so a ping, and then the receiver, which is like the listening ear, will wait for the return signal, so the echo. And then based on what we know about how fast sound travels through the water column, so how long it takes to go from the ship to the seafloor, and then from the seafloor back up to the ship, and that gives us depth.
We survey one strip of the seafloor, and then turn around and survey an adjacent strip, creating a giant 3D map of the seafloor. Don't forget, this is an active volcano, and even today, it's still generating a lot of heat. There's still a strong potential for an eruption. So the Tangaroa is keeping several kilometres away, and rather risking human life by getting too close, we're using autonomous submarines and autonomous vessels to map those waters around the volcano itself. And that's actually revolutionary. This is the first time that we've actually had a truly combined approach to autonomous vessels, as well as an international team on board on Seabed 2030 to really analyse the gaps in our existing knowledge of the seafloor and to map volcanoes like this. The first thing we found, in fact, was that the edifice itself, the mountain itself underwater, is more or less intact. But what we did notice was significant, what we call erosional channels, and these are debris scours, and this indicated that there were very violent, strong, turbulent volcanic flows that happened during the eruption that rolled down the mountain underwater eroding these huge channels and actually creates these jumbles of massive hunks of rock just tumbling around, ripping out the seafloor. Now in Hunga-Tonga Hunga-Ha'apai, we found these flows radiating out all the way around the volcano. It's these extra materials from these flows that destroyed the communication cables through Tonga. When we get to a site, the first thing we do is deploy the DTIS camera system, and that's to give us a good first impression about what we expect to see on the seafloor. We were expecting to see what we call the typical seafloor life in the deep ocean. That is lots of animal burrows, lots of tracks, lots of snails and crabs, and we just saw desert. I mean, I've never seen anything quite like it. It was just smooth, pristine desert, no animal tracks, no burrows, just no life. It was just mile after mile of this devastation.
We're going to finish recording here. The depth is 1170 metres. We can bring the DTIS back up, please.
But also, we surveyed a wide range of topography, deliberately targeting adjacent seamounts close to the volcano itself to get a better understanding of whether animals could have survived. And there were pockets of biodiversity that we think are what we would have expected to have been there originally. Where it blew out the sides of the caldera and flowed down the flanks, some of these other seamount features were not in their path, and they seem to have escaped the direct impact. So it looks like they've survived at distances of 10 to 15 kilometres from the eruption itself.
The ground truth of the video happens through lots of different types of equipment. The first thing we do is deploy a multi-corer which sits on the seafloor and then presses down six tubes into the sediment and retrieves those cores of sediment that we can put back onto the boat and analyse.
Our Japanese scientific community are very much keen to involve analysis of such dredged or collected samples. Japan is a volcanic country like New Zealand and Tonga, and there are 111 active volcanoes. About one third of active volcanoes are distributed in the ocean as submarine volcanoes. So we have to also know how submarine volcano works.
The things that the eruption would have done to the ocean is deposited a lot of nutrients, and that would have come from the ash. So the ash would have limiting trace metals and lots of things like nitrogen and phosphorus that animals need to grow. One of the things that we started seeing when we were out here is that there was this particle layer in the water column, and we interpreted that as an ash layer from the volcano itself. When we were really close to the caldera of the volcano, we could see a lot of those particulates at around 200 meters water depth in the water column. We put those on the microscope and we were able to see glass crystals, we were able to see minerals, and when we filtered those onto our water filters, we were able to see really, really dark coloration on the filters. And we wanted to kind of trace that throughout the water column and do some experiments to figure out what nutrients the ash from Hunga-Tonga Hunga-Ha'apai actually contributed and what type of organisms that helped support and did it potentially harm some organisms.
The voyage is finished and we've collected a vast amount of data, and all this material that we've collected will now be distributed to our collaborators in order to start doing the scientific analysis to really understand what happened not only on that event when the eruption happened, but what's happening now after the eruption as the seafloor changes and the water changes because of that eruption.
So So we're leaving Wellington and flying down to Dunedin to see our colleagues at the University of Otago and work in a really specialized facility where we can do some scanning electron microscopy and some electron probing of different particles to start figuring out what's happening in the ash layers that we have found in the ocean. No, that little shard? Yeah. Based on all current indications, think is a product of continued venting from the caldera. Aggregations like that fundamentally change the way that that ocean is going to be working, that part of the ocean is going to be working.
Tsunamis caused by volcanic eruptions, it's not just one event that happens and then that's the tsunami. There's often a range of things, the explosion themselves, pyroclastic density currents from column collapse. The pressure wave from the explosion can reinforce those tsunami waves. One of the really interesting things is actually this atmospheric forcing. One, it's amazing in terms of all around the world, you know, you actually see this wave traveling around the world multiple times, but in the near field, there's actually a very different story. It's actually traveling slower, but sort of increasing in speed. And that's super important because if the atmospheric pressure and the tsunami are traveling at the same speed, you get a really massive increase in the size of the tsunami. If you live on the Ring of Fire, it's not just those local earthquakes that you need to worry about. And I mean, obviously with Hunga-Tonga Hunga-Ha'apai, when you get this volcanic meteo tsunami, the fact that it can pump energy into the whole system as it travels out means that it can still cover all of the Pacific and then some.
We now know that there is actually a giant caldera in the summit that's now 850 metres deep. And that brings up our volume estimations of the amount of material erupted to be close to 7 or 8 kilometres of material that's being erupted from the volcano. You know, you want a simple terms, it was a shotgun blast directly into the sky. It went beyond stratosphere into the mesosphere, and it's the highest ever eruption column ever recorded in human history. We also know the SEA-KIT actually detected in the multibeam new venting. There's a new cone that's growing within the caldera. Part of the validation process we use to really confirm that these pyroclastic flow materials are what we're actually seeing is that we sent these cores to get scanned in a CT scanner where we can actually look through the cores in different slices and actually understand the structure within them. We know now from these preliminary results we have from Otago University CT scans that we are seeing that chaotic structure, and that leads us to believe that we are getting pyroclastic flows over 80 kilometres away from the volcano.
We've always underestimated submarine volcanoes. There are 5 additional just surrounding Tongatapu. It means we need more planning and urgent planning.
If these sort of volcanoes like Hunga-Tonga Hunga-Ha'apai can erupt that way, then what's to say an island off the coast of New Zealand, Japan could also do the same things? And these are really fundamental problems to humanity, and it's the sort of thing that only through knowledge and exploration can we actually really begin to manage these processes and these environments correctly. There's so much work to do in that region, and we only really scratched the surface, and we've got enough results that are amazing, and it's going to take many, many years to work out fully, but there's still so much more work to do.